So first we need to know that what is the origin of the judicial power of United States. So it is derived from Article 3 of the US Constitution. What does it refers? The Article 3 of the Constitution states that the judicial power should be in one Supreme Court and in other inferior courts as the Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. So the judicial power is not only vested in Supreme Court but also in courts that the Congress can establish from time to time. Now, what does Congress here mean? The USA's legislature is actually and popularly known as the Congress, and it has two houses, the House of Representatives, which is the lower house, and the Senate, that is the upper house of the US Congress. So the power, as you have read here, is mentioned and has been vested in one Supreme Court and other inferior courts as established by Congress. Now, some of the salient features about the judiciary in USA is, to begin with, it is a two-tier system. What does that mean? In USA, there have been established two separate system of court. So at the national or the federal level, you have the federal court, and we know that the United States of America has 50 states. So every state has their own judicial system. They have their own courts. So here, simultaneously, two sets of judicial system are existing. One, the federal court, and second, that is the courts that are existing in all the 50 states of the federation. It is important to clear at this at the outset that here the topic for our focus, the discussion, will center around the federal courts and not the judicial system that exists at the level of these. Now, even at the federal courts level, we have to understand that there are two types. The first is the Constitutional Court. It includes Supreme Court, the Court of Appeal, and the District Court, and simultaneously with them, there functions the Legislative Court. Now, these courts are created by the Congress. So these are legislative court because they are established by a legislative body, that is the Congress, and it includes tax court and courts of military appeals, to name a few. The third is the independence of judiciary. Now, judiciary is an independent organ and it cannot perform its duty efficiently if there is any kind of pressure on the judges. So, what are the factors that ensure that they are independent and do their fulfill their responsibility in an efficient way? That is a long tenure, good salary, pension, their appointment by the president. All of these factors together ensure that they do not come under any kind of pressure or they perform anything that is unethical. Is the power of judicial review. It is also an exclusive feature of the US judicial system. In fact, the Indian Constitution has borrowed the idea of judicial review and incorporated it, being inspired from the United States of America. What does review means? Review means revisiting and understanding the laws and the actions. Now, here the US Supreme Court reviews all the laws that are passed by the Congress and all the action that the president takes. In case if the Supreme Court finds that any part of it is violating the Constitution, then the Supreme Court can declare that particular provision as null and void, which means to temporarily, to permanently cancel out and prohibit the Congress and the president from going ahead with those provisions. And what is the utility of having the power of judicial review? It keeps the federal government and its branches in a check, and it ensures that no one is exceeding, or it limits each organ of the government and ensures a balance of power. However, it is pertinent to mention that this power of judicial review is performed or can be performed only by the Supreme Court, that is the highest court of United States of. As far as the organization of the federal judiciary is concerned, we have the district court, which is at the lowest level. Then we have the circuit court of appeal. And lastly, and at the highest, we have the Supreme Court, which is the apex court of the federal judicial system. So any appeal from the decision of district court can lie to the circuit court of appeal, and any kind of dissatisfaction with the verdict of the circuit court of appeal can be passed on to the Supreme Court of the United States of America. We also have the legislative courts. Now, what are these courts? These courts are not constitutional courts. They are created by the Congress, and therefore the name legislative court, since I have discussed earlier, Congress is the legislative body of United States, and here the legislative courts are established by the Congress, and they are highly specialized court. Why so? Because they perform specific tasks. For example, the Court of Military Appeal reviews court martial cases, the Court of International Trade deals with all kind of trade disputes, and then there is territorial courts and Court of Claims. So these legislative courts function along with the other courts of the federal judiciary. To begin with, firstly, we have the district court. It is the lowest level federal court. In fact, all the 50 states, there are 50 states which comprise the United States of America. So all the 50 states have been divided into judicial district, and each of these districts has a court. Now, these courts perform the task of addressing both civil and criminal cases. They have original jurisdiction, which means that citizens can directly approach these courts in case of any civil or criminal matter, and appeals against their decision can go on to the intermediate level, that is the Circuit Court of Appeals. And as far as the judges of District Court are concerned, they are appointed by the President with the approval of the Senate. Next in line is the Circuit Court of Appeal. The 50 states of the United States of America are divided into 13 regional circuit. So all the states that come under those circuits can approach the circuit court of their jurisdiction, and each circuit court hears appeal from the district courts that lie within their borders. And in case of any kind of dissatisfaction with the verdict, the appeals from the circuit courts are taken to the Supreme Court of the United States, are taken to the Supreme Court of United States of America. Demonstrate this fact, we have a map of the United States of America. We can see here that the entire country is divided into 11 circuit courts of appeal, and all the areas marked under this circuit, for example, the color yellow, it denotes all these states which come under the jurisdiction of this circuit court. So all the cases arising, they can approach this. For example, all the sections and countries which are under the color blue, they can appeal to this 10th circuit court of appeal, and likewise. So total there are 13 courts of appeal which perform the task of addressing the issue. The highest court of the US judicial system is the US Supreme Court. It is the apex tribunal in the nation. As far as the composition of the US Supreme Court is concerned, it consists of the Chief Justice of US and such other number of justices that are fixed by the Congress. So presently, the number of these judges are fixed at 8. So this is the apex court, and there is no other court which is higher in power or capacity other than the Supreme Court of the United States. The method of appointment for the judges of the Supreme Court is as follows. They are appointed by the President of the United States after consulting the Senate. So all the appointments are made with the advice and the consent of the Senate, and the qualifications of the judges of the Supreme Court, there is no such formal qualification which is mentioned in the Constitution. Only persons with high legal qualification and experiences are appointed as the judges. Next, we'll discuss the tenure, the method of removal, and the quorum for the Supreme Court judges. The tenure of the judges, they have a lifetime tenure, which means that once appointed, they remain in office until they resign, retire, or are removed from the office. And the method through which they can be removed from their position is only when they are under the grounds of violating the Constitution. They can be removed through a process referred to as impeachment. And which is the organ that performs this task of impeachment? It is the Congress, that is the House of Representatives and the Senate. So the House of Representatives frames the charges, and it is the Senate which acts as an investigative agency and gives the verdict. And lastly, the quorum. So at least a minimum of 6 judges are required to constitute a sitting of the Supreme Court. Now we'll discuss about the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, that is the areas in which the Supreme Court can act. Here there are 2 categories. The first is original and next is the appellate. Original means all those cases in which one can directly refer to the Supreme Court or can approach the Supreme Court, and the second is appellate, where you can approach the Supreme Court only through an appeal. So all the cases in which ambassador or foreign agent is involved, in which there is a conflict between 2 states or of the US Federation, or if there is a conflict between the federal government and a state concerned, in all these cases the parties concerned can approach to the Supreme Court. In case of appellate jurisdiction, the Supreme Court receives appeal against the decisions of the federal courts, and even the state courts, the highest courts of the state, can approach the Supreme Court through the method of appealing to it. What is the role of the Supreme Court? What are the tasks or what are the functions that the US Supreme Court provides for or plays? First of all, it plays the role of interpreter of the Constitution. Now, the Constitution has a lot of provisions which are ambiguous, which cannot be understood. So, it is the US Supreme Court which gives its interpretation, and its interpretations are final and cannot be challenged. The second is role as the guardian of the Constitution. So how it is acting as the guardian? It can declare any law or action of the executive as invalid. So if there is any attempt to invalidate or violate the Constitution, then the Supreme Court takes a decision and declares that law or action as invalid. Thirdly, the Supreme Court also protects the rights of the individual. So, in case anyone's fundamental rights are violated, they can directly approach to the US Supreme Court. And lastly, because of its power of judicial review, the Supreme Court also acts as a lawmaker, interpreting new laws and giving new dimensions to law. The most important part of our lecture is the judicial review power of the Supreme Court of United States of America. What is judicial review? Judicial review means all the actions of the executive and the legislature. So if there is any rule that the executive has framed, or if there is any law that the legislature has framed and it is violating the Constitution, then it can be declared as null and void by the United States of America. Now it is important to understand that The Constitution of United States of America does not mention about the power of judicial review. It is the result of a Supreme Court decision. And what was the case? Marbury versus Madison. So you need to know that this power that the Supreme Court of USA is exercising is not because of any constitutional provision. There is no article that mentions about judicial review power. It has come out because of a judicial decision. And what was the decision? The decision was that the duty of the judicial department is to say what the law is. So ultimately, the true meaning of law is the responsibility of the judiciary to finally spell out. So the judicial power, if you see the Fifth Amendment to the Constitution of the United States of America, it mentions about how the judicial review power is to be exercised. So here, if we read, the government cannot deprive anyone of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. So this is the guiding principle for the judiciary while exercising judicial review. Now, what is due process of law? In case of due process of law, what does the judiciary see? While interpreting any law, the judiciary will conduct two steps. First, the first test will be to see whether a particular law is framed by following the correct procedure or not. So the first test is to see the validity by seeing whether the law has been made by adopting the correct procedure or not. The second test is to see whether the law that is finally made is fair or not. So here the judiciary will not be only concerned with the legal aspect, but will also be concerned whether that law is ultimately, it is treating the individual rights properly or not. So in case the Supreme Court finds that the law is not fair, it will declare it as null and void. So the government, when it decides to take away anyone's life, when it tries to take away anyone's freedom, it has to do so by following the due process of law. So first, it has to see whether the law has been framed in the correct manner and whether the law that ultimately has been made is fair and just or not, or whether it is simply arbitrary. So this is very important. If you try to compare it with the Indian Constitution, that talks about the concept of procedure established by law. So in case of procedure established by law, the government can take away anyone's life and liberty if the sentence or decision has been made by following a law, and if that law is, the provisions have been followed, then the government is free to take any step. But due process of law is a more wholesome process where the validity of a law and whether it is fair or not is also observed and taken. Now, a quick critical evaluation of judicial review. Firstly, obviously, it does not find mention in the Constitution. So there is no constitutional provisions talking about judicial review. Second is that because of its power of judicial review, the judiciary has started acting as a super legislature and super executive, because it is somewhere performing the role of lawmaking also, and it is also spelling out the rules, which is normally the task of the executive. Just juxtaposed with this is the third point, that is, the Supreme Court at times acts as the third chamber of the Congress. So it is the role of the Congress to make laws. So by performing judicial review, the Supreme Court is also ultimately involving itself in lawmaking. Fourthly, it has politicized judiciary. Now the judges, while reviewing any law, cannot do so by separating themselves from their political ideology. So at times the judges can also get influenced by their political views and can give biased review of the laws of the Congress or the actions of the executive. And lastly, it lowers the prestige of the Congress. Now it is said that the Congress makes an effort and makes laws, and it is ultimately the judiciary which can declare that law null and void on the grounds of violating the constitution. So these are some of the demerits of the power of judicial review. However, in a truly democratic country, it is very important that the judges perform their task of being the guardian and the interpreter of the constitution, where they can adopt their legal experiences and legal knowledge in ensuring that the Constitution is a living document and is fulfilling its role in the times of change and is performing the task of safeguarding its individuals or not. So judicial review has its own merits and demerits. This is it for today. In case of any doubt, kindly drop your comment in the comment section below, and also give a quick feedback about the lessons, whether you are benefiting from it or not. Stay safe, stay healthy.